There lived at one time a woodnymph named Pomona, whose skill in the care of plants and trees have never been equaled. She hardly noticed the rivers and forests, but loved the fields and orchards. These were her passion, her life. She didn't disdain Aphrodite as much as ignore her. She kept aloof from any suitor. There was, however, one suitor, the god of springtime, Vertumnus. He was
in love
with her more than all the rest.
He adored her.
In the manner of the Shire gods, he used to disguise himself, would put on the clothes of a farmhand, wear a straw hat and a working man's shirt, and stick hay stalks behind his ears to look like some storybook yokel.
Howdy.
Would not produce nothing. He thought he might hold his hand a pruner, trying to look like a field hand who tends the grapes in their arms. After the complete failure of that, he came with a ladder to seem as though he were bound for some nearby orchard to gather apples. With wigs, costume, and makeup, he once tricked himself out as a soldier, romantically returned from foreign wars. Another time, he set himself up as a fisherman, fishing in her path on the chance she might pass by. He waited, from dawn to dusk, passing from boredom to terror and back again.
The point was just to be near her.
Stand there and gaze at her beauty.
And to maybe wish her good morning.
Or
good afternoon.
Or
good evening.
Until he plodded on by.
I live for these trivial moments.
One day, he put on an old woman's dress and a wig and wandered through the green, green hills until he saw his beloved standing in the lavender.
Lovely. Truly lovely, but Eunice, I love you still. Just look at that, would you? And see how that tree and vine complement each other, complete each other. Separate they aren't much, but together they're splendid. There's a lesson in that, one that you might consider. The way you've been keeping to yourself is no good. A sad violation of nature, as well as a waste. A lover is what you need to make yourself complete as a woman. You'd have many choices, I think. As many as Helen. But there is one in particular I'd recommend for Tumnus. I know him as well as I know myself. And I warrant, I guarantee, his eyes are for you alone. Consider he's young, healthy, attractive, and strong. Your tastes, too, are similar. For he likes the trees and gardens almost as much as you. Besides, he's fun. He likes to take on various disguises. It's a game he likes to play. Believe me, you may take these words that I speak as if they were coming from his own mouth.
None of this was working.
Listen, aren't you afraid of offending Aphrodite? Don't you know the story?
What story?
The story of Cinnamus, his daughter Mira, and Aphrodite.
No?
And he began to tell her.
Part one, the mistake. There is a girl like you named Mira. And she too ignored Aphrodite. She wouldn't fall in love. There were suitors everywhere, but she was blind to them. Finally, Aphrodite had had enough and seized her with a passion. And it was a passion for her father.
That isn't true.
It is.
You can shut yourself in a room, bolt the door. But love will come through the window. Draw the curtains, lock the casement, but love will seep through the walls. Never think, never think that you can be saved from love.
She struggled hard against her passion.
Oh God, I pray you keep off this wickedness. Make me a daughter to my parents. Even to think what I'm thinking is a crime. Or is it a crime? The animals I've seen will do as they desire. A ram goes to the ewe that he has sired, and birds will make a nest with those the nest once held. How happy they are to be so free. But we have laws! Yet there are countries I've heard with no such laws, where in the dark the bonds of love, already strong, might be made perfect. Why do I keep thinking of such things? Leave me alone! He is the best of men, the best of fathers, and I am his daughter! You have been virtuous in body, Mira, and now be so in mind.
Mira?
Father?
Why are you crying?
It's nothing.
Why should a girl like you be sad? There are suitors at her door every day, yet you keep refusing them and weeping in the corners of the house. Is there someone special you're hiding?
No.
What are you waiting for?
Nothing.
None of them pleases you?
No.
What kind of husband would you want?
One like you.
May you always be such a good and sweet girl.
Midnight came and sleep crept into the palace to fold men in his arms. But Mira, she could not sleep. Tangled in a dream of her father, she tossed all night long. Like a tree once wounded by the woodman's axe, that leans first one way in the wind, then another, hesitates, but always falls.
Part two, the solution.
Mira! What are you doing? My child! What are you doing?
Leave me alone!
What is it? Let me help you! The old are not altogether helpless. Has someone bewitched you? Spells may be broken. Or have you angered some god? Still, you may look to appease by prayers and sacrifices even the heavens' anger. What else can it be? Your mother and father are well.
whatever you want. I swear by the gods to help you. Only tell me. Your father will never know.
Go away!
But why?
Go away or stop it! Stop asking why I grieve! It's a crime! The thing you're trying to learn is a crime!
This went on and on, but the old nurse would not give up.
Oh, mother, mother. Happy in your husband. How does your mother have?
Oh, child, whisper in my ear and tell me I am wrong. I swore to help you, and now I must. Tomorrow your mother leaves for the Feast of Ceres. She'll be gone 9 days. Your father will drink. He will be likely, as any man can be, to listen to my suggestion. That a very pretty girl knows you, loves you, wants to visit you in your room. Can she?
She's attractive?
Yes, and young.
How young?
Your daughter's age?
All right, then.
There's one condition. She is very shy and afraid for you to see her.
How charming.
Part 3, the corridor.
In the small hours of the night, when all was still in the palace, when the moon had fled from the sky and the stars were concealing themselves in a shroud of cloud, the girl set out for her father's apartment. She stumbled, recognized this as an omen, but nevertheless turned down the hallway. Clutching the nurse's arm for support, she continued down the corridor. The hall was apparently endless, but then, too soon, they arrived at the door.
Your girl is here.
Part 4, unnameable.
Slips out of the room, guilty but shameless. And the second night, she returned.
It's twice as long as it seems.
Dissolved into tears.
And this last was not a mere expression, not some rhetorical term or poetic and hyperbolic trope, but simply the unadorned, terrible truth. She stepped into a shimmering stream and began to dissolve. Her body melted.
And then she was gone.
This story got Vertumnus nowhere.
Wait. Why are you wearing that ridiculous wig?
I don't
know. And that idiotic dress.
I'm embarrassed.
Take it off. Take it off.
When finally the god revealed himself just as he was, much to his surprise, he had no need for words. Little Pomona was happy with what she saw, unadorned and undisguised. Soon enough, the vine was clinging to the tree.
Well, my parents were separated when I was really little. Like, before I was even born, it was sort of a one-night sort of thing. Except it was in the day. In a meadow, where my mother went to go watch my father pass by every day. Anyways, I always knew who my father was, and I'd see him go by. I mean, who doesn't? But I never really knew him, and he wasn't around. I mean, not around, you know?
Where better might we find a more precise illustration of premature initiation than in this ancient tale of alternating parental indulgence and neglect?
I go to an expensive school that is filled with a lot of boys who are, well, you know, sons of the rich and famous. And one day we're on the playground, and this kid, Epiphus, he goes to me. He says, "So, Phaeton, blah, blah, who's your father? What does he do? Blah, blah, blah." And I say, "He's the son." You know what he says to me? He says, "Tell me another." And I say, "No, really, he's the sun. He's Phoebus Apollo." And he basically just trampled me. I mean, beat the shit out of me, like I was lying.
Neither his own opinion of himself, nor the regard for him, or lack of it, in his peers, obviates the father's primitive role as initiating priest for the younger being. Now it cannot be contested that the absence of this figure is for the son an almost irredeemable loss.
So I go home, and I say, "Mom, this happened, you know, at school." And she gets all upset, crying and everything, because she still loves him, and it's an insult to her, too. And I say, "Well, if it's true, how come there's no proof? It's no fair to us, you know, that there's no proof." And she gets even more upset. And she says, "Hear me, my darling! I swear, by his splendor, you're his truly begotten son! That fiery orb you see crossing the sky each day, whose heat enlivens and enables the earth, and orders her very days and nights, is indeed your sire! Blah, blah, blah!"
When he matures beyond the customary Eden of the mother breast, the child seeks to individuate beyond its enfolding gaze. He turns to the new symbols of the paternal realm, thus beginning his spiritual passage from one sphere to the next.
So she tells me to go over to the valley where my dad goes to work every morning and just ask him to set things straight, to, well, you know, do right by me. So I set out, and it's hot, and it's dusty, And it's a long way across Ethiopia. And I hitch part of the time, and I walk part of the time, and finally, I get there. And the hill is steep.
But this passage is never easy.
So I get to the front door, and there are my dad's three secretaries, the days, the hours, and the centuries. But they recognize me, so they tell me to go on in. And there he is, all shining and golden. I mean, he's so bright, I can't even see him. And you know what he says to me? He says, my son, you're welcome. Speak, Phaeton, to your father. I can't tell you what this means to me. I just tell him everything. I just spill my guts. You know what he says to me? He says, let me grant you a favor. Anything you ask for shall be yours. And he swears to it.
The conventional exordium of the initiate from latent to realized potential is inevitably accompanied by a radical realignment of his emotional relationship with the imago of parental authority.
There's only one thing I want. I mean, it's obvious, right? I say, give me the keys to your car. Immediately, he starts backpedaling, saying it's his job, and only he can do
it.
You
can't do it.
And then up in the sky, there's a bull, a lion, and a scorpion.
There's a scorpion.
You get me. And I say, it's my turn. Give me the keys to your car. You promise. I want to light the world today.
The father or his substitute must be assured before he transfers the symbols of adult vocation that the son is no longer operating from infantile complexes that may dangerously redirect his new task through unconscious promptings of self-aggrandizement, personal preference, or even resentment.
Where have you been all my life, Dad? It's my turn. Hand it over. So he hands me the reins. But he wants to give him advice. Like, don't fly too high, nor too low, stay in the track, so slipwise. But I didn't listen.
Myths are the earliest form of science.
It was over before it even began. It was chaos, okay? It's like no one was even driving. My knees were weak, my eyes were blinded by all the light and guidance. Well, I set the earth on fire. And then I fell. And it just destroyed me. I mean, completely and utterly destroyed me. O-V-E-R, over.
Said that a myth is a public dream. Dreams are private myths. Unfortunately, we give our mythic sides scant attention these days. As a result, we lose sight of a great deal and no longer understand our own actions. So it remains important and salutary to speak not only of the rational and easily understood, but also of enigmatic things, the irrational, the ambiguous, to speak both publicly and privately.
Who is this?
This is Eros, god of love.
Why does he have wings?
So he can move quickly from body to body.
Why is he naked?
To make us transparent.
To make us what?
Transparent and undone. Foolish to others. Exposed.
Why is he blind?
He's always pictured blind, but he really isn't.
Because in love you're so... ignorant and so compulsive.
There's that.
What else?
He's blind to show us, and he takes away our ordinary vision. Our mistaken vision that depends on the appearance of things.
Who's this? Coming down the stairs.
Her name is Psyche.
Psyche? Her name is Psyche?
Yes.
What's she doing here?
She's married to the god, but she's never seen him before.
Why is that?
If
forbids it.
How do they mean it?
Psyche was so beautiful. The goddess Aphrodite hated her, so she sent her son down to punish her, but he fell in love instead.
Does she know that he's a god?
No. She suspects he's a monster.
Have they had sex already?
Oh, yes.
And how was that?
It was good.
Then why does she suspect he's a monster?
Her jealous sisters told her so.
And she listened to them?
Unfortunately, yes.
So now she's coming to watch him as he sleeps?
Yes.
To make certain?
Yes.
With her eyes?
Yes, she's very young. It happens all the time.
She doesn't trust what she's felt herself?
Not with the radical trust we need.
What does the word psyche mean?
In Greek, it means the soul.
What's going to happen to her now?
She's going to suffer.
What does she have to do?
She's given horrible and lonely tasks by Aphrodite.
Such as?
Sorting thousands of little seeds, one from the other.
How did she manage?
Some little insects help her.
Like in fairy tales?
Like in all the fairy tales.
What else?
She had to go down to the underworld, fetch various things.
Wasn't she afraid?
She was petrified, but she did all the same.
Wasn't it hopeless?
It was hopeless, but she did all the same.
What did love do in the meantime?
He healed his little wound. It hurt him so much when she looked at him like that. The wax fell on him and burned him.
How does it end?
She finishes her tasks, and Zeus declares enough's enough.
He overrides love's mother?
Yes, and further him. He gives Psyche a special potion and she becomes immortal. Then he declares that their marriage will last forever.
Does it?
Of course.
So it has a happy ending?
It has a very happy ending.
Almost none of these stories have completely happy endings.
This is different.
Why is that?
It's just inevitable. The soul wanders in the dark, and until it finds love, where we find our soul.
It always happens?
If we're lucky, and if we let ourselves be blind.
Instead of watching out?
Instead of always watching out. One night, Zeus, the lord of the heavens, and Hermes, the messenger, came down to Earth to see what people were really like. They disguised themselves as two old beggars. They were ragged and poor, stinking and filthy. They knocked on a thousand doors.
Hello, do you have any-
Get out of here! Get the hell out of here! I work hard for my money!
And a thousand doors were slammed.
Hello, we're tired. We live on the street, and we were just wondering if you
I'm
might
sorry.
Be
sorry. I just can't right now. I'm really sorry. I just can't. At last, they came to a little hut on the outskirts of town.
Why bother knocking here? We've knocked on the houses of people who have plenty to give. Whoever lives here has nothing for us.
Let's give it a try all the same. We've come all this way.
This is useless.
Just go home.
Poor strangers! Philemon, there are guests at our door!
Hello, we're strangers to these parts. We've lost our way and-
Baucis, why are you standing there? We must bring our guests inside!
Do you know us?
Of course! Yes!
Then who are we?
Why, you are children of God! Please come in!
The two immortals, satisfied with
entered the house, lowering their heads to fit through the door.
No, don't sit on the floor. Sit on chairs as tall as you can be.
Philemon ran to get another chair, and Bowser fetched 2 pieces of cloth to pad them, so that the strangers might rest easily. She sparked a coal in the hearth and fanned the fire to cook them a meal.
Philemon brought out the cloth that they saved for feast day.
Bowser saw that one of the legs of the chair was short, so she propped it up with a shard of a pot.
Philemon set out a plate of olives, green ones and black, and a saucer of cherry plums.
Then there was cabbage and some roasted eggs. For dessert, there were nuts, figs, dates, and plums.
And a basket of ripe apples.
Do you remember how apples smell?
At last, with a show of modest pride, they brought out a bit of honeycomb. For sweetness.
Philemon began to pour wine from a bottle. But as he filled the glasses of the 2 guests, he saw that the bottle remained full.
And then they knew.
Oh, mercy, mercy.
Why, you are divine, and we have served you such a simple meal. Bassus, go and kill the goose.
Let it be. We are gods, and we thank you. You've done enough, much more than your nasty neighbors thought to do.
Suddenly, everything is changing. The poor little house, their simple cottage, becoming grander and grander into a glittering marble-columned temple. The straw and reeds of the thatched roof metamorphosed into gold, and gates with elaborate carving sprang up as ground gave way to marble pavement.
Old man, old woman, ask of us what you will. We shall grant whatever you request.
Having known each other all our lives, we ask that you allow us to die at the same moment.
I would hate to see my wife's grave or have her weep at mine.
The gods granted their wish. Arrived at a very old age together, the 2 stood at what had once been their modest doorway, and now was a grandiose facade.
When Faustus noticed her husband was beginning to put forth leaves, and he too saw that she was producing leaves and bark, they were turning into trees. They stood there, held each other, and called before the bark closed over their mouths.
Farewell.
Walking down the street at night, when you're all alone, you can still hear stirring in the intermingled branches of the trees above the ardent prayer of Faustus and Philemon. They whisper,
let me die with the moments my love dies.
They whisper,
let me not outlive my own capacity to love.
They whisper,
let me die still loving, and so never die.
Best of the worst of the worst. Christ, Jesus Christ in heaven.